Hi, this is Marlene Gibb with What Do You Do? And today's guest is Sharla Hicks. And Sharla, what do you do?
I'm primarily an artist with a strong background in mixed media, quilting, crafts, arts and crafts. I think that's been very core to what I've been doing. And along the way, I became a lover of computers and what that had to do. And all of these grew into what I would call the accidental businesses as I was growing up.
And it's a good term.
Yeah.
That's a good term for it. Okay, let's start at the beginning. When did you realize that you liked art?
Early. I still see in my mind's eye the stained glass picture that I did in grade school that was about color. And color has followed me through the whole time of what I do. I'm very much of a colorist, and that's followed me through. And I did crafts, like I made a little bunny thing for all the kids. My mom still talks about that. They went and bought milk cartons just so I could make bunny baskets. And that was a big deal. We had a farm, they milk cows. So to go buy milk so I could make bunny baskets was a big deal. So they were, by the time I was in my teens, I was sewing.
So. Really? No, they offered sewing classes then. I mean, in my high school, they did.
Yeah.
Home economics.
Yeah, I took one. It wasn't creative enough. They wanted me to make.
What did they want you to make?
Square aprons out of checks and ugly skirts. So I went ahead and started making real clothes, right off the bat, creatively putting in sleeves. Showed my teacher. She said, oh, that was very creative. Because I didn't know about gathering your sleeve in, so I pleated it in.
Oh.
Yes, little things like that. So I've always been a person who kind of didn't follow the rules. If I didn't know what to do, I would figure out how to make it work. And still a good. So that was early.
And that you weren't raised in California.
No, I was raised in Idaho.
Okay. When did you come out to California?
Well, I married my husband early, and we progressed with his job. You know, you often, as a homemaker, and you progress down. So we moved from the Idaho Falls area in Idaho, and we moved to Salt Lake. And there was a grounding place where I started learning how to teach and stuff. I was active in my church, and I was in charge of the homemaking meetings. And so I was teaching women arts and crafts. So early on, I was kind of honing these skills to what I'm bringing to the work now. And so then we moved to Salt Lake with another, then we moved down here to another transfer. Southern California.
And you decided you weren't going to move after this, right?
I suspect had there been a job move, maybe we would have, but I was grateful we didn't. We moved twice here, and before that we'd moved 13 times. So I was ready to not move so much. And the kids were older. They needed to stay in their schools and things like that. So that was important to us.
And that was, and you moved to Anaheim the first time or the second
time?
The
second time. We were up in Saugus up until then.
Okay.
And that's actually when I began my quilting. That's when I started, I had started a small home business of boutiquing where I was doing a lot of handmade crafts, and I put those on consignment and went to shows and different things and sold those and didn't think I'd ever sew again. I was like, after 2 years, like, oh my, I don't think I can do this anymore. And I saw a quilt class, and I walked by the swim room and I'd shudder. So I walked by the quilt class, found that quilt class and decided that works. I'll go take that. And it was like a whole new world. It opened up, I must have made a couple hundred quilts. I still own fabric that fills a 19 by 27 foot studio.
Wow.
So, yeah, it's a big deal. And,
quilting is a big deal because when I met you, we have a common friend, you know, and which I thought that was very interesting. But she's a quilter, and I have three girlfriends that are quilters.
Mm-hmm. It's a very, I think people think it's a dying art, but I think it's like any other hobby. There, you find a passion and a group of people come together in what we call quilt guilds and do it. And so I started, it was a training ground for me in which I began recognizing more and more that I had, that this could become an art medium for me. And I quilted for the biggest share of 15 years.
What do, when people quilt, they have themes and motifs, and then you have historical quilts. Do people have all kinds of quilts, or do they?
Yes, there. It's a wide range. You have the people who are hand quilters who like to actually hand piece and put everything together by hand. You have the quilter who does machine piecing. And in the days when I started, there wasn't machine quilting, where currently there's a lot of machine quilting. But I came in with a background of machine embroidery, which was another one of my little entrepreneurships down earlier. And so I came, and by machine embroidery, I meant freehand machine embroidery, because today machine embroidery means the machine does the work. Right. I was doing the work freehand, but with the aid of a sewing machine. So I was doing monogramming, landscapes, pictures, flowers,
wow,
learning a lot about color, then about how to put together thread colors to make beautiful flowers. And so I've had this training that's been taking me through that of color, then the machine skills that I got through the sewing early, dressing the family in my 20s when they were, till they figured out they prefer store-bought clothes, so stopped dressing the family. So I had this set of machine skills that I brought to quilting that in the early 80s when I started quilting was very unusual. I still remember one lady informing me, well, you're the best machine quilter I've ever seen. And it was like, really? Oh. Because it was natural for me because I had this free motion background. So for me, it was, you know, so that was my introduction. And I've always been, I would say, at least 5 years ahead of my, to 10 years sometimes, but definitely 5 years ahead in whatever industry I happen to be in. Because I always pushed toward the art side of it.
And you know, quilters, I don't know, because my friends are all quilters, but, you know, sometimes it seems like it's hard to make it a business if you're trying to, the hours, it's the hours for the dollars, and sometimes they don't work out. You know that.
Yes, yeah. I often would have people say, well, you should sell that, and I would say, doing it 100% on machine, which I did, a small quilt that would maybe be 36 by 48 or something like that, still took 40 hours.
And then
a large one took 100, you know. That's a lot of hours that people don't always value as far as trying to sell a quilt. So I never found that to be where I wanted to put my money. Plus, I get attached to my babies, and I don't want to let them go.
I know.
I still own all of them.
My girlfriends gave me quilts. My grandson was born last November, so we got quilts, and I, you know, I hear about the quilting, and I'm thinking, that's an awful lot of work, and it's just from a business standpoint.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how.
Well, I think most people who go into quilting and turn it into a business, they become specialized in what they do. They invent a product. They teach classes, they lecture at guilds, offer workshops, so you kind of use it, which is the journey that I took. I started out teaching in the local quilt shops, and then I started teaching when I felt like I had something unique to offer. At some point, I felt like I just had the same things everybody else did, except those machine quilting skills. And
so that was going to play a part in the business plan.
Yes,
ahead of time.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. So those all added up, and I also became a specialist in computer quilting. So where you design your quilt on in a software on the screen, and then you can it'll tell you how much fabric to buy, how many pieces to cut, and you can also see what a possible finished product was. You can even scan your fabric and put it in. So you could buy a fabric and scan that in and then put that in your quilt to get a sense of what that might look like in the finished overall piece, so you have a real visual.
Wow, it's like the old, what was the old patterns that you had, the old dress patterns,
yes.
Where they would show you all the, this is the pattern, these are the alternatives.
Mm-hmm.
So you kind of did that, but you did that to the for the computer.
Yeah, and you had the combination of computer graphics underneath this. So like your Corel Draws and your, you know, your Photoshops.
Right.
Those became part of how the computer quilting software was developed. And I'm one of these people that if I know something about one, I have to know about them all. So I was one of the very few who knew all the softwares in and out, all the quilting softwares. And at one point in time, there were probably about seven.
Really? Corel Draw. When we were in the computer business, we went to the shows, and they would, you know, when they showed Corel Draw especially, you know, it looked so good, you know, like with the teachers, and I would say, they didn't like it. How long does it really take to learn it, not to do this?
Mm-hmm.
And there was always this silence, because I bet there were 50, 60 hours to learn Corel Draw, right? All those packages are heavy.
Yes. And I didn't focus so much on that. I think one of the things that I think is unique to my teaching skill is I understand the beginner and what they want to know.
Right.
So that was one of my little entrepreneur businesses. I wrote 7 how-to dummy quilting software books. 7. They kept reinventing the software, and it got to the point where I'm going to be spending all my time writing computer quilting software books, how-to dummy ones, and because I didn't focus on a single software, made me unique. And I also understood people really wanted to do what you're talking about. If you drop down X and you go to X and then you do X, you're going to get X.
Right.
And so that's how I wrote my books. And I could take people through a program in 23 to 28 pages.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, they could go from beginning to end and know the ins and outs. You weren't designing a quilt. You were learning how to pick a block, how to color a block, how to, you know, add a block, you know, different things like that. But then I just broke it down to that, because that's what people wanted to know. They wanted to get to the point that they could be creative with the program.
Exactly, exactly. The dummy books are good because I'm at that, I've done it in other things, I'm at that stage, you know, when I get a new software, I don't want any advance. I'm still a beginner.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all I want to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the average person, because they're not going to remember what you told them anyway.
Well, and people often get frustrated. Well, I really need to learn this. And I said, I call it the need to know factor.
Oh, yeah.
You usually don't learn something until you need to know.
Right, that's true.
Yeah. When I was writing the books, that's when I needed to learn more. And I remember in the quilting world when I was teaching, I had all my things, my handouts on the computer, and I couldn't get in. It was still back in the DOS days. I couldn't get in. Called my friend Harper and said, I can't get in. And we were on the phone for 3 hours. And she finally said, well, which direction was the backslash? And I think that's the day I decided I needed to learn more about computers. 3 hours to get to a backslash. And that was where I came from. You know, I came from not knowing anything, so I really was excellent at helping the beginner understand, okay, this is all you need to know. You know, install that baby and open it up, and then this is what you're going to do. And you're going to step through 1, 2, 3. And I feel like it's one of my stronger skills that I have taken with me throughout the businesses that I've developed.
Yeah, well, you seem to be good on the business side and the computer side. Now, how did you, how did the quilting business grow so fast?
Yeah, I had a business called Soft Expressions, and I call these things accidental businesses because I started selling the software because in the 90s, when I was teaching these classes, the quilt shops were afraid of the software, so they wouldn't carry them. They were a $100 investment, and you know, that would require a student to shell out $100.
Right.
So therefore, they'd rather buy a $100 bolt of fabric than a $100 software. So I started carrying the software. I even sold them to the shop owners so they could make a little bit of a profit on them. And so that started, and then I wrote the How-To Dummy books. So then that started this core business. And I started an online business under the name softexpressions.com. And that evolved to, my husband walked in one day to about 150 products. We had about 150 products.
That's a lot.
Yeah. Well, my husband walks in one day and says, you know, we could open a store. And I said, what? He says, well, we just moved to this new building, and I got on the board, and I went to the board meeting, and one of the buildings in the complex is for sale, and we could put a store in there. I reminded him of that today, and he says, I started this? It's like, yes, because then we grew from 150 products to 10,000.
So how big was the 150?
Oh, we ran that out of the back of my husband's accounting firm.
Oh, okay. Which, yeah. Okay.
So we had this tiny little business in there. So
did people come in and out to pick up supplies?
We would have, it was online. I was okay. One of the very first people to do it online. And we would have people who would ferret us out and walk into these ugly little places where we were shipping out of. We moved up to, he moved his office from Costa Mesa up to Anaheim, and when we did that, the office needed remodeling before they could move up. So we were in this dirty, dingy place, and people would show up. And I remember the first Christmas. It was so interesting to be so early on in the industry of online shopping. You didn't even have shopping carts then. You had a fax number, and people wanted to see it, so they would ferret you out and show up and come in and want to buy the product there. And at Christmas one year, I had three staff members by that time, and we had three phone lines, and they were ringing nonstop. They wouldn't stop ringing. Everybody wanted the software. They wanted the software.
This was back in the early 2000s?
Early 90s. No, mid-90s.
Okay, okay.
About there in 97, 98, in that time frame. And so I thought, oh my stars, next year we're going to have to get more lines because, you know, we're growing our business. Each year, you know, our orders are growing and we're putting more product online. And the next year, we didn't get as many phone calls, and I didn't have to put in that extra line. And the year after that, we didn't get as many phone calls. And then we'd start, it was a 15, 20-year span in there. And now, then there was a period in time where we got the panic calls. Can you ship this overnight? As a gift, so I get it on Christmas, and then or Christmas Eve, and then we would tell them the cost, and they said, "Well, maybe afterward. Maybe I guess okay afterward. I'll print the page and wrap it up." So they would print the page and wrap it up and put it in, you know, in the package, so that they knew that they were going to get something, but they didn't want to pay that $40 or $50 fee to get it overnight, you know. So it was interesting to be in the beginning and evolve from a fax, you know, where I just had a printed online order. And then we got a little shop, and it was still about, at that time, I still had about 150 products. So we started with some of the early online shopping software. And then when Ern walked in and said we should grow this business, then all of a sudden I had 10,000 products to try and figure out how to get them online, how to stage them, because I was self-taught, and I literally did all of it. I did
But you got out of the but you got out of the more creative part.
Yeah, I did.
And then you were in, yeah. Well, it's creative. You did, yes, all the staging, but what I'm talking about is what you were doing, yes.
Yeah, the art side of me, the actual physical hands-on teaching classes and that kind of stuff, really, we started early on to try and do it, and then it turned out we were in the incorrect zone, and it was, so that didn't work for us. So that turned into a problem. So we just, I kind of just got completely away from the teaching and all my creative energies. And it takes a lot. I think that there's, my personal opinion is, there's a window of creativity. And when you gobble that up, there's not a lot left for over here.
Right.
So it was, and my personality also isn't split focus. When I focus on something, it's 100%. So that was difficult. I couldn't find time to quilt, even though I was running a quilting business with all the supplies, fabric, the notions, and the art, the textile side, the surface design side, which was where my real love was. I was moving toward the art quilting side for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I also had this machine background from the free motion. So I had this combination of threads and...
threads are very important to you, right? Yeah. Yeah, that's the colors of threads.
Yeah, the colors of threads. And so I had tons of threads. I had tons of the sewing machine feet. You could come to my store and people were just fascinated by the selection, because I had all the way from paints to these, the threads and feet for your sewing machine. And we also found great gifts, like Laurel Birch was a beautiful designer, so we carried a lot of her products and that kind of stuff. So we had this wide range of products that we were carrying. And very fulfilling on the creative side. I didn't actually, those first 10 years, miss the art very much, because I was so absorbed into designing what the store was going to look like, designing what the website was going to look like. Directing my staff how they were going to put what categories and what pictures to scan and what to type, and and then developing the templates. I was writing how-to dummy books for my staff.
Right. Well, it sounds to me like you were just channeling that creative energy, but it wasn't your real love.
No.
But it was, you were channeling it enough.
At that time,
you weren't doing accounting.
Yeah. No, I wasn't. We have a quote-unquote family-owned business,
right.
And I do have an accountant,
right.
Son and husband, who, they did all that. If I had had to throw that variable in, it wouldn't have worked for me.
That would have been a hard one.
Yeah, and they didn't have time to work on the side that I was working on, so it really was a good match as far as, but they loved going to shows with me and helping me pick out product and stuff. They said it was fun to watch.
Yeah, well, I imagine.
When that first time when I walked in and just, walked the whole show, and I actually had I could buy what I really wanted and all this. That was really, that was fun. What a way to take care of us shopping, that need to shop, whoa. So that was, it was very rewarding. Those first 10 years. And I actually find computer work extremely meditative, as strange as it sounds. At that time, I was actually doing a little bit of tutoring on the side, and I came in to teach somebody one day. Just flying off the kite, I'd taken somebody to the airport, and I felt late and all the stuff, and sat down to that computer and felt all the tension go away. And so, for me, being in front of the computer is very calming and very meditative, except when I'm in the learning curve. So that's why I write how-to dummy books.
It's meditative to me when I go into the research mode.
Yes.
That is very meditative. The rest of it, no.
Yeah. I was shocked, because that was the first day that I had understood that there was a quietness that would come into me when I did that. But to sit down there and physically feel that tension literally evaporate, it was like, oh, I love computers. I love what I'm doing. I like teaching people. I like working through this process of helping somebody else learn what I learned. No, it's, I really feel like I've always taken the philosophy, if I learned something, I taught it. So if I If I learned toll painting, I taught it. If I learned freehand machine embroidery, I taught it. If I learned quilting, I taught it. And as I got into my 30s and 40s, that's when I started taking it to a higher level, where I began teaching the in the quilt guilds themselves, and then doing workshops, and then being invited to do national workshops. And
yeah, but you were covering a lot of ground. You were the speaker, you were the CEO.
Yes.
You know, I mean, you were doing so many things.
Yes.
And just that, you had a lot of hats.
Mm-hmm. I did.
Almost too many.
Yeah. Because as the business grew, this was the 150 products was very manageable.
Mm-hmm.
10,000 plus.
Very
some that never actually have even gone online. Some that are still sitting in boxes. I'm going, oh my stars, that's still sitting in a box. That became all consuming, where there was only room for the business. And I started missing that, and I could feel that hole growing. I didn't realize it, that the computering wasn't quite enough anymore, that, you know, whatever that was. I have a philosophy, I don't know whether it's true, but I see it in students all the time, that if you can't figure out how to evolve and grow and morph within what you're doing, then you move on to something else. And
That's very interesting.
Yeah, I've seen it with quilters. If they didn't find their passion and how to continue growing in it, they would move to crocheting or painting or drawing or something else.
Is it because they just got bored with it, or what happens when you kind of?
I'm a philosopher.
Okay,
I did some.
That's one of your things,
yeah,
too.
when I was in. I was actually a psychology major during my early 20s when I was started to college at 25. I didn't go. I was raising a family early, and then at 25 I decided I need to go to college, and I was going to be a psychologist. So I was still training to be what I am today, even though I never finished that degree.
You're never going to finish that one.
I know. I have 120 units in Sharla's BA. I call it Sharla's BA. They won't put that on a plaque. But I have 120 units in Sharla's BA that ranged all the way from, because when I was in the middle of this quilt making, I began realizing what I didn't know and what I needed to know more. So I went back to college at the small JC down there.
In Fullerton College.
Yeah,
I read your bio.
And that was powerful. Because in a very short period of time, I met what I called an artist mentor. His name was Don Hendricks, and he's no longer with us. But I was so excited because he believed in vocabulary. Mm-hmm. And a lot of creatives aren't necessarily very verbal, but I'm extremely verbal. So now here's an artist, phenomenal artist, who took me under his wing, who believed that his gift to his students was to give them the vocabulary of art. And when he gave me that vocabulary of art, the simple techniques that actually apply across all creativity, like repetition, variation, composition, symmetry, asymmetry, approximate symmetry, and how to make all this interesting. And then I added in drawing classes that taught me more about shade and shadow and these kind of things. And as strange as all this is, even though I've written a book called Tangled Inspired Botanicals.
You were going to talk about it.
Yeah. I am not an art. I cannot. I am an artist. I cannot draw realistically. Turns out I'm dyslexic also. And there's something about a disconnect between line and interpreting it on the paper and seeing planes. I don't get all of that. And I tried, honestly, and just never found the 100% joy in it. And that was sad for me, because I could paint, I could color, I could do all this work, I could make quilts sing, but I couldn't draw a picture, and I was so sad. And
but you've compensated for
yes,
it.
Yes, I did.
I mean, really have compensated.
Well, what I did is in 2010, I went to a CHA, which is a craft show, big craft show, and I ran into one of the vendors. You know, I'm hunting the floor for the latest new product to go into my new store, and I ran into this shop, this, you know, booth that was featuring Zentangle. And it's like, oh, my, what's that? And I was immediately gravitated to it because these were designs that I had done in my Fullerton College days 10 years before. And thought, oh, well, look at that. And so I went home and did huge pieces, 9x12s, for 9 months, these huge pieces. And pulling what I had just kind of grasped by just looking at what they had. There, some books came in and I kind of looked at them real quick and just kind of started doing my own thing. And introduced it to my friend Harper, who we both met a few last week. And she came in one day and she says, I think we should go to CZT training. I said, well, what's CZT training? I didn't say, so what's CZT training? I knew what it was. I said,
what is it?
I said, well, we should, oh, CZT training is Certified Zentangle Teachers.
Okay, now let's stop right there. Explain Zentangle, because all of us, you've got to explain this to us here.
Okay.
Tell us what Zentangle is now.
Zentangle is a form of drawing that some people call doodling, and it is a form of doodling. It's also a form of what I call repetitive patterning, and it's based in what we use for writing or printing more than writing, mostly printing. Straight lines, circles, curves like S curves and Z curves.
I like the S curves.
Yeah. So it's based in this, and what you do is you break down a pattern or a design. For me, I love florals, so I can look at a floral and say, okay, there's an S curve here, and I can, you know, I can get this general shape using these things. And all of a sudden, that grief, that sadness that I had that I couldn't be an artist completely went away because I could pattern, and I'm really good at it. And
that was your aha moment.
That was, yes.
That was your major moment.
Yeah, yeah. And
it's kind of like your blouse, yeah, because you wore this
yes.
blouse.
Yes, we have this
blouse, and that's yes. very similar mm-hmm. to.
Yeah, and
because this is black and white, that's yes. why you can see all mm-hmm. this very clearly.
Yes.
Yeah. See, when I see it with that, I mm-hmm. don't see the.
You don't see the patterning. Yes.
I don't see the patterning as. Mm-hmm. as I do in that in your mm-hmm. blouse.
And Zentangle itself, this is actually called Zentangle Inspired Art.
Right.
Because it goes past traditional tangling, which is done on a 3.5-inch square with four little dots. And actually,
us.
I don't have one
but
of
you
them
have
there.
This, but you have something.
I have these.
Okay. So Steve can catch those.
This is one that's sort of free motioned.
Okay.
This one moves past. Most of my work move past really quick. So, but what you do is a series of step outs. Let's go to where the step outs are, so that actually shows it better. So here's a picture of a rose set right there.
Okay.
And this here, you start with this small form here.
Okay.
It's kind of a spiral. All of us can draw a spiral. This one happens to be a squiggly spiral. And then I add a petal to it. And then I come back in and I add a second petal. And I repeat, until I come over here where I add a little bit of what I call weighted line to it. And then I add shading. And this is a Tangled-inspired piece in that it's not a... It is based in your step-out patterning, and it is black and white, but it's bigger than your 3.5-inch square. So this, but that's the concept that you're based on, where you take these small steps and move them from there. There's another place where I show this real clear.
You wrote this book too.
I did. yes, this is my book. Whatever I do, I teach, including write about them for some reason. This is another step out where you're working with these rounded corners. This is called Tripoli, and all these patterns are named. So remember I talked about the vocabulary connection that Don Hendricks had introduced to me?
Right.
Zentangle has this vocabulary connection in that each pattern has a name. So here it starts with this small triangle. You build around there, then you build outside that. And I give you a few additional instructions down here on hints and tips that I found along the way, because Zentangle, this wasn't easy for me. This actually, there was something about that must have hit all those other points that I still had trouble with drawing. So I spent 4 hours in a pickup one day learning how to draw. And this was the work that I was working with when I first started. And you can see, and when at the end of this 4 hours, we were finally up to our cabin, and I was sitting down at a table. And after this 4 hours of practice, I created this. So that was the piece that I created. And at that point in time, it was...
And that was all black and white, right?
This was all black and white with shading. Okay. And at this point in time is when I had told myself, I don't have to do it perfect. Because Zentangle isn't based in perfection. It's based in what you can do in variation. And I recognize that I can bring that concept of variation to the work. And the fact that there's multiple sizes in there was an accidental happening based in what I could draw at the time, based in this information that I was learning here for the first 4 hours ahead of time. And so
when you're doing this, there's structure, mm-hmm. there's structure, but then you could make these things, these triangles bigger, so you don't have to be perfect. You could.
No, we've got overlapping in here. We've got really strange stuff that doesn't even work right in here. But it didn't matter, because the best part about patterning is when you put it all together, it just works.
Right. Well, yeah.
It just works. And the whole world is based in patterning. There's, when you introduce this to a child, they're running around the world. Well, look at that. Well, look at that Zentangle, Grandma. Look at that Zentangle,
yeah,
Grandma.
They
see it. And adults do too. They say, you actually start seeing the world in a new way. And that's really significant. Because, and for me, it was just this opening up. And I spent a year working in mostly a journal that was 6x6. So that would be a 6x12. Right. And 3.5-inch squares. And that's all I did. And in the black and white with shading. And I was, and about the same time I started taking these printmaking classes. And my friend Harper came in one day. I told her, I wrote her a little note in her copy and said, you know, without you, this would not have happened. And she says, well, I don't want it. We were stamping on them to make bookmarks on the uglies, the pieces that were ugly. And she says, I don't want to do that. I want to Zentangle on mine. Oh, okay. Hadn't put the two together. And there was Harper thinking freer than, she's a very free thinker. And she said, so I said, okay, we'll do that. And she did that, and I went home and produced, I was making bookmarks like mad out of the really ugly pieces. And that turned into what I now do. I take printmaking. A print can go all the way from, they can be absolutely beautiful, and I didn't grab any of the beautiful ones to show, but this is a black and white version. I mean, on black paper.
Okay.
And this is a ghost. This is a second or third print. Oftentimes, your first print is really pretty, and so sometimes I don't even play with those because they're too gorgeous.
What's a ghost?
It's when you run these through a press, or a printing press. But you can also hand press with a little thing. You can rut, you can all, gel plates.
Yeah, yeah.
All kinds of things that people can make prints with. So they make the prints, and then when you can make more than one print off of what's left on the paper,
right,
then you start getting these pieces that have, that are interesting. And then you often come up with these, what I call the uglies. Okay. And I wait for the uglies, because the uglies are what I turn into.
Well, they look
into.
Like rope sharks. They do.
Things that most people would throw away.
Oh, well, they got a lot of, I like the colors.
Yeah, the colors are good. But what I like to do is then take a piece like this and start turning them into pieces that look like this. So now we have...
So you can have this and turn it into this?
Yes. This piece that I did here was genuinely awful. And it has a very Baroque, it's very rich, very gorgeous. And it sat there for probably 3 years, and I just never did anything with it. And one day I said, well, you know what? I need to pick it up. I know that I turn the ugly ducklings into something gorgeous.
With your pretty threads too, gold in that.
Glitz is my thing. Glitz keeps showing up no matter what I do. It does show up a lot in my work. I just like to add that little extra edge.
So how do you take something like this, this one,
mm-hmm.
and make it into something like, that's a botanical back there, right?
Mm-hmm.
So how do you do that?
Because
there's not much pattering. It looks like a rose shark.
Yes. It's intuitive.
Okay.
What I do is I have this extensive background in mixed media, color pencils, different things like that. So I use that. But the first thing I do is put line on, and I will come in here and find a flower and or a leaf. I think this is an obvious leaf shape right here.
Right.
There's another obvious leaf shape. These aren't as obvious, but when I look at this, I see the potential for perhaps a black-eyed Susan, you know, the ones with the cone flowers,
yeah,
the cone thing, and then some petals coming off of that with a slant. And I came to these through Zentangle, in that I learned the concepts of strings and how to fill strings. And
now
then
what
I
are strings?
Strings are the little windows that you draw inside of, that you draw your pattern in. And so I would come in here, and this would become my string. So the color becomes my pattern.
Okay.
And then I study botanicals a lot. I garden too. So gardening, and I always go to botanical gardens when I'm in another area just to see what they have to offer that's different than what we have. And I photograph a lot. I went to an iris garden in Salem this spring, and I called it the 600 photograph day. So I did 600 photographs that day.
Wow.
And there's a lot of intimacy with learning how to see when you're looking through the camera.
Yeah.
And so I begin absorbing these pictures that are, you know, the...
But you have a very good...
essence of it.
Yeah, but besides the essence, you have a very good design, even with this.
We need to be holding something a little nicer.
Right.
Here, it's going to turn into some beauties like these.
Yeah.
So these became a signature style, and tell you the very moment in time when that happened.
Your name's not on it, is it?
It's right there.
Oh, okay.
It's right down there.
Okay.
Right down there. When I was at my cabin one day, I had a tangle that's a ghost, because it's not real strong. It was prettier than this one. But I sat down and started finding the flowers and the botanical forms, moving past traditional tangles, which often are checkerboards and lines and very more structured. And I just started intuitively drawing what I was finding. And I often start in a place where, when you look at the work, oftentimes you can see where it started because it's a slightly stiffer area. This is slightly more traditional Zentangle down here. And then my brain just shifts and starts seeing other stuff. And so then I just, it slowly evolves. And most of this is just in the ink, at this just line at that point in time. And then I come back in with color. But I was sitting there in a red chair from morning till night with the light shifting. And as the light shifted, it would also tell me where I needed to add more shade or more shadow or more spark or more highlight. And when I got done, this piece had evolved. And I'm going, oh my stars, I'm home. I'd found it. This was completely unique. I had moved away from traditional Zentangle, but brought all that information that I had learned in patterning to this piece. And that was the beginning of where what I'm working now. And this is what I actually, this is where what I teach now.
So this is your one of your first pieces?
This is one of my first pieces in this style.
In your style?
Yeah, in what I call a consummate style, that somebody can look at that and say, that's Sharla.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Most people get into their style, don't they, if they stay with it a long time?
If you do. People ask me, how often do you draw? I literally draw probably every night. These pieces are not large, and they can be done in, my husband likes TV. I like TV, I listen, he watches. If I miss something, I say, can you roll that back?
Yeah, right.
So I have the perfect duo there. So he's my compadre there when I'm doing my art. He's always looking over, watching, seeing where it's going and all that kind of stuff. So, but if you put the time in, and you find the thing that brings the joy, like, but why didn't I stay with the drawing? I often look at that. Why couldn't I stay with the drawing? It didn't bring the joy. It gave me a stomachache, even when I was okay at it. At some point, I became okay.
Yeah.
I never became good. My mentor told me that. He says, 10% of the class is above you. For a perfectionist, that was just like telling me I'd failed.
He didn't mean anything by it.
Oh, no. I felt he was completely, because, the rest of that story. I went into tears. And he put his arm around me. He had seen my quilts, and he had seen how I put fabric together, and he had watched me through a design class where he was offering me this vocabulary. And I was in, and then the next semester I started the drawing class with him, and he says to me, Sharla, you are as good a designer as anybody else out there. You are a really good designer. And that was the day I knew I was an artist, that it was okay to be an artist. He had given me this permission, and I only studied with him three, 4 months max, and then he was killed in an accident, and I lost him. But the person who literally put his stamp on me as an artist, and I have taken that with me, and that's what I offer my students, is I want those that came from that place where they're not confident as an artist, or they fell away from art because somebody said a callous remark, or it didn't meet your expectations. Like I said, I'm not a realistic drawer. I moved away from that. It didn't feel good.
But intuitively you knew it.
Yeah, yeah.
But you know, it's funny.
We
know things about ourselves, and some things are, you know, intuitively whether you like it or not.
Mm-hmm.
But
mm-hmm.
yet we want that.
Mm-hmm.
Someone's saying you're okay,
mm-hmm.
and I've learned it's okay not to be okay at whatever.
Yeah,
certain,
yeah.
And I don't beat myself up. I guess it's age too. But I don't beat myself up over it anymore.
Well, I thought was powerful on all of that was the the draw, even though I couldn't, didn't feel like I wanted to continue drawing realistically, I learned so much more about shading and lighting, and that all became part of what I'm doing here. Right. I bring shade, light, contrast, values. I make decisions when I go to do a piece. Okay, I'm going to do a medium value piece. This one is not as strong. This one doesn't have as strong of light and dark. I make a choice to do that when I do these pieces because I enjoy the challenge of, can I meet that? It's not all, oh, I like those colors. It's what else can I do? And I've discovered that there's little techniques, some one I call simultaneous contrast, where I can create more drama by bringing in a different color pen and outlining. And these are, so every day I'm discovering something new. And so it's like
that mix and match whole thing. Yeah. You think, will this work or not?
Yeah. And is every piece successful? No. I have some genuinely ugly stuff. And I show students the good, what I call the good, bad, and the ugly.
That's important.
Yeah, so that they understand that I, not everything I do is gorgeous, that you can see, or, you know, if you come to me, you're studying because you like my style. So, but not everything that I did, and that I had this progression. And when I went to CZT training, the Certified Zentangle training, I actually was terrible. I mean, the pieces I did. Now, by the time I got on the plane to go home, I was good again. But actually there, I was struggling because I had been working on these great big pieces in a very kind of different way, slightly different than this step-by-step patterning. So I was trying to absorb what they were teaching me about step-by-step patterning versus just, you know, kind of free-flowing whatever I wanted to do. And so I didn't feel particularly successful there, but on the plane began applying the things that I knew, including shade and shadow, and the pieces just, you know, yes. It was like night and day between what I was doing in the retreat, or in the training, versus what I was doing on the airplane going, flying home. So, and I have a dear friend who spent, she spent 2 years struggling. She would Xerox and redo and redo and Xerox and redo. She didn't want to work on the original piece. And if it had been that painful, I doubt if I'd held on as long as she did. But she found that meditative quality, like I was talking about with the computers. That's what Zentangle drawing does, is it brings a quietness because there's a stroke that you can do. So you have this stroke and you just grow quiet with it. And it's why you see so much patterning as a choice in art, in tapestry, and all kinds of things. That there is something about that.
Well, it's calming.
Yeah, very.
The patterns are calming. I mean, you don't mm-hmm. want to look at chaos all the time. Mm-hmm. I don't think people like chaos. That's disruptive.
Yeah.
It's disruptive to the body, to the mm-hmm. mind.
And there's something about patterning that is that repetition of a similar thing or the same thing that really does. In fact, as strange as it sounds, checkerboards are quieting. They often make beautiful backgrounds in the work, and I'll add them to pieces and they add to it because there's something about that patterning that just frames things and balances things. And it's just very powerful what patterning does and how much. There's people who will tangle. I do tangle for the joy of the art and making the art. Other people do it for the meditative piece of it, and some of them never get past the black, just working in black and white and maybe adding shadow. They just work primarily in.
Well, it's like I do meditation, and it's constantly you're working with the breath. And within 5 minutes, you may, when I first start, you know, my mind is not there. And then once I start, you know, saying in and out, it starts to settle down, and that you have that.
Once you can, to take the mind and quiet it with a strong focus.
Right.
And for those of us who find meditation difficult, mm-hmm. this is a beautiful way because it does the same thing. It calms the mind with the simple repetition of your line. Just talking about it, I get quiet.
Yeah, you get quiet. So we're going to wrap up this quietness. So I want you to look at the camera, and say your name and your web address.
I'm Sharla R. Hicks. You can also find it under Sharla Hicks. And I have a website called sharlahicks.com. And I also have another website called softexpressions.com.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Oh, this was lots of fun. This is Marlene Gibb with What Do You Do?
I just had a delightful time with Marlene. It was wonderful to get to talk about what I do and how I've evolved to this point. And I'm very good at working with the beginning to intermediate artist. And one of my goals is I wrote the book Tangled Inspired Botanicals, and that gave me even more definition on how to talk to people. And I teach classes in Anaheim, and I teach longer retreats, which is where you really get into the in-depth work of working with your color and your mixed media in Big Bear and across the nation. I've actually taught in several locations around the country. Going to be doing, and it's so exciting. To come to see me, my name is Sharla R. Hicks. And you can find me at Sharla Hicks. That's spelled with an S, by the way. Sharla, not Charlotte, Hicks.com. And softexpressions.com. I'd love to see you.